comes, fine. If not, also fine. I was invited here to, I was invited to give, and I spoke with Janice about that I would give three different lectures, and today I spoke to him that I was thinking about the topic of science, Krishna consciousness, and particularly Darwin, evolution, intelligent design, and so on. I've given this presentation, a similar presentation last year, and also I gave it in Gule Villaen. How many were you? I mean, you were there, or Krishna Bhakti?
No, I have to say, I was not there.
They haven't seen it? Okay, good. So, then I can just, because some of it will be the same that I've given before, and there's also be different things. I'll just, be completely brand new to at least my presentation on this topic here. So, of course, let's see. It's a topic that I've been fascinated by for many, many years. Prabhupada, he spurred my fascination or my being drawn to the topic of discussing science in the context of Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada was very much keen on not only presenting Krishna as the Supreme Personality Godhead, but he also wanted to demonstrate that actually there is a Supreme Personality of Godhead. Here there's a quote. This is Prabhupada from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Purport in Srimad Bhagavatam, where he writes that the person who always desires to serve Krishna is interested in ways to convince people that there is a Supreme Personality of Godhead and that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is Krishna. That is his ambition. So, and that's of course very apt. How are we going to convince people that Krishna is a Supreme Personality of Godhead when many think there is no such thing as a Supreme Personality of Godhead, that God does not exist? It's a very prominent trait in modern society. People are doubting about the existence of God. Many are even convinced that there is no God, that laws of nature, matter is everything there is. So, before convincing anyone about Krishna's existence, we have to first take the basics, even convince people that this active God does exist. So, that is the devotee's ambition. And actually, you see, Prabhupada was as enthusiastic, even more so, about explaining people how God must exist and also how we must be souls. Even though he explained it many times, but you see his, his enthusiasm and his, he never got tired of explaining, for example, we're not this body, or even when he was on the, in his later years, the last year he was here, and sometimes he was so sick he could not speak with anyone, but when he had a chance to speak with Sravadamana Maharaj, his scientist, he could even speak with him, even though he was too sick to speak with anyone else. Which shows actually, even though it might seem to some degree mundane, but actually to even explain that God must exist is just as transcendental as speaking about any other part of our philosophy, and also as relevant. Especially here now, because as it, many things of God does not exist. Ultimately, what we want to get people to is convince everyone about that the nature, the reality of nature is, as this is a quote from Bhagavad Gita, that the Supreme Lord is situated in everyone's heart or Arjuna, and is directing the wanderings of all living entities who are seated as on a machine of maker material energy. I'd say ultimately the Rodin's understanding of nature is that nature consists of three things. We have matter, and we can exemplify this with our body, which is a body made of matter, it's a material machine. Then there are living entities who are seated on that machine, and then there is a supreme lord who is driving the machine and guiding the living entities. And nature is consisting of those three elements. And I'd say, in terms of science, that this is, you know, to demonstrate the existence of the supreme personality of God, and that is actually what we have to demonstrate. But anyway, I'm just going to look at the scientific arguments for the just very basic things. And we are of course going to have a discussion here a little about Darwin. Prabhupada point out the importance of looking at this so-called scientist, he says here, the so-called scientist Darwin. Scientists and people after this so-called scientist Darwin. We want to stop this misleading. That is our duty. So one might say, why is Prabhupada so, especially, you know, what is it Darwin? What is it, why is it not Einstein? or something like that. But no, it was Darwin he was especially critical of. And why? Well, I mean, the thing is that there has practically been no other scientists. I mean, here there's a quote from one famous modern biologist, Ernst Mayr. And he says he's no biologist, but he could be as well a scientist, even a broader category. But as you know, biologists has been responsible for more and for more drastic modifications of the average person's worldview than Charles Darwin. And this is from actually, he said this in Stockholm actually. Dr. Mayr, he received a prize, not the Nobel Prize, but he got another big prize. And at that time, he pointed out actually that Darwin had changed everyone's worldview. Like someone, again, if you take Einstein, he definitely had a big influence in the field of physics. But when it comes down to, I mean, the average person, like the majority of people, Einstein didn't mean that much, except that he was famous, but he didn't really change people's worldview. But Darwin, he turned everything upside down. There was a time in the West culture before Darwin, there was a time after Darwin. It was a quantum leap, even though it was before the theory of quantum physics, but it was a quantum leap in a radical change from one worldview to another worldview with Darwin. So what was it that Darwin he did? Well, that is explained here also. Another biologist, modern biologist, he pointed out that Darwin's greatest accomplishment was to show that the complex order and function in living creatures can be explained as a result of a natural process, natural selection, without having to refer to a creator or some other external factor. This is actually what Darwin did. He showed basically, if you really boil it down, that you can explain life without God. That was the idea among scientists before. But Darwin claimed to have demonstrated, well, you don't need God or a creator or something to explain life. You can explain the origin and the evolution of life with just the laws of, you know, nature, laws of physics, chemistry, basically. This is really what Darwin is all about. It's not only that humans come from monkeys, or this is just a detail. The real big thing is that he said we can explain life by natural processes alone. And this has, of course, very great consequences. It means you can actually be an atheist and you can still be a respected intellectual. Here's Richard Dawkins. He's if you know, everyone knows Richard Dawkins by name. So that's what he said. Darwin made it possible to be an atheist actually and still be a respected intellectual. That was doubtful that was possible before, but after Darwin that was possible. Also, it meant with Darwin that basically the purpose of life simply disappears, because all we are is a result of a purposeless and materialistic process that didn't have us in mind. We simply chance. And because that's what really evolution and Darwin means. And it just happens, and there's no purpose to anything. So what does that do to, you know, our worldview, and why in the 27th century has mankind been plagued by the feeling that everything is so purposeless and there's no meaning to life and like that? Why is that? Well, because the underlying worldview is that actually everything is purposeless. So how can you think that? That is what science in the name of Darwin has been claiming over, the last more than 150 years now. So probably had good reasons to attack, particularly Charles Darwin. And as you might may know, famous, he said actually the more I think in some, when some of our editors and books made a little modified, softened the progress, I think probably he basically said, the more you kick down the face, the more you make spiritual advancement. So, we promised to do that. So, that's what some of us are trying to do, because we need badly to make some spiritual advancement. That's a great thing. The idea that you can explain life without God is not an old idea in science actually. Many have the idea that there was a schism in the West always between science and religion. And that's not true. It's simply not true. Practically all the scientists were theists, they were believers in God. Maybe they were skeptical about the doctrines of the church or something like that, but they were actually theist and religious people. Simply because, because they were studying nature. And here, for example, one example, I couldn't say any scientist before Darwin practically. Here, Isaac Newton, probably the biggest scientist ever who lived, wrote in his most famous book, amidst a book with volumes and mathematical formulas and calculations of orbits of planets, and it's from Newton's Principia, which was the basis actually of modern science. Then he writes that this most beautiful system of the sun, planets, and comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent and powerful being. He said that it's not possible to explain the solar system and such an orderly system unless there is a intelligent and powerful being, being God, behind it. That's Newton. Or if you take Carl von Linné, or Carolus Linnaeus, I think that's his name in this English-speaking world, in Sweden, he's Swedish. Probably the greatest true biologist. Maybe Darwin is more famous as a biologist, but as a real scientist, as a biologist, Carl von Linné was probably the greatest biologist who ever lived. And he, all the living species and life forms were classified by Carl von Linnaeus. Like for example, that human beings be known as Homo sapiens. Two Latin names are given to each species. This is Linnaeus' system, and he classified the whole, animal kingdom, plant kingdom, and we're still using the same classification systems that he made. So, but that does not mean that because he was able to put the whole Living Kingdom into a big hierarchy. So this is evidence of evolution. So this is the unfolding of a plan of God for creation. And here there's a quote from Linné. He writes here, "I saw the infinite, all-knowing and omnipotent God. I followed his footprints over the fields of nature and saw everywhere an eternal wisdom and power and inscrutable perfection. Even if we go as far to up to the present day as 1857, here is a quote from a professor at Harvard. He was actually Louis Agassiz was actually one of the biggest scientists in the 1800s, and he wrote in a book that the living world shows also premeditation, wisdom, greatness, prescience, omniscience, providence. Natural history must, in good time, become the analysis of the thought of the creator of the universe as manifested in the animal and vegetable kingdoms, as well as the inorganic world." So this, again, we have one of the world's biggest scientists writing that, you know, the purpose of, and he says here, natural history, that was actually the word for biology in the 1800s. He said actually biology should be a study of the thoughts of the creator of the universe. So that's science before Darwin. But again, Darwin changed all this. 1859, he published his most famous book called On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, where he claims that actually it's possible to explain the origin and the evolution of all life forms simply by natural means. He writes here, "I view all beings not as special creations, but as lineal descendants of some few beings." What Darwin's claim is that species, living forms, are not specially created. Special created means they're created separately. Each species is created separately. And that was the idea before Darwin. Generally also Linné thought like that. Each is created separately. But Darwin thinks, no, they did not arise separately. There was one or a few life forms in a way back in an ancient era. And these, by, you know, multiplication, variation, and evolution has diverged and become all the many, many different life forms we see in front of us now.
How come that Charles Darwin at this time had such a humongous impact?
He just hit the right. He was in the right time. Because actually Darwin himself is not really the origin of the theory of evolution. Exactly. There were others before him who have proposed theories of evolution. Of course, Darwin, he's able to explain it by completely natural means. Actually, others also before him, his own grandfather, wrote a book almost, not a complete century, but 60, 70 years before him, actually proposing the same theory. And there was French Lamarck, and there were actually many. It was kind of in the time. Mm-hmm. In the time, it was a fringe idea. It wasn't the mainstream, you know, but it was in the time, and it seems also, I say, scientists were defenders of religion, but science was the last vestige of the defenders of religion, because in those days there were, you know, actually from the beginning of, even from the Renaissance, but also in the 1600s, 1700s. More and more, they're philosophers, they are political people, different people in the service. You know, there are attack on the, at least on the church, and in religion from many, many sides in the leading up to the time of Darwin. But scientists, they are actually those who are defending religion.
Yeah.
So, but Darwin is like he. The spark in a barrel of gunpowder. You know, it was the right time.
But this statement of Darwin, can't we just agree with it that there were just Prajapatis in the beginning, or all the birds came from Garuda, all the snakes came from Vasuki, and...
Let's take that after. I mean, because right now I just look at the arguments for things having arisen completely natural. And if you, and you know, because of course there might be ways in which creation can take place, which where things evolve, and we do talk. I mean, we do talk about an evolution. There is an evolution, but it's an evolution from, as you say, the Prajapatis going down, you know, going for the higher beings down to the lower species, such as us, and it's also kind of an evolution, but it's not a natural evolution as Darwin talks about. Mm-hmm. So for now, I'll just have a look at this idea. I mean, is natural evolution actually is that reasonable? Is that reasonable? Darwin claims it's reasonable, and biologists who are still adherents of Darwin say it's, you know, it's completely reasonable. Just like, let me just point out here that. Darwin, he actually is arguing against special creation. Each species are separate created. Sometimes someone will say that in a scientific context, one should not introduce ideas about creation or God like that. If that's true, then Darwin should not have a place in science, because he has that idea, but he's arguing against it. Which is, I think, is fine, but it's also fine to argue for it. It all depends on what is the evidence. Just to be clear what Darwin actually is arguing. And here he also explains himself what was the purpose of the origin species. It's from another book where he explains here the purpose. In the origin species, I had two express purposes in mind. First, to show that species had not been separately created. And second, that natural selection had been the most important cause of change. So Darwin is arguing against creation, special creation especially, and he's arguing that natural selection, or in general, natural processes are the, you know, the cause of change in nature. This is what Darwin is arguing. And again, Professor Ayala points out that was actually what Darwin, he showed. He demonstrated that you can't have life without a creator. That is. So, of course, if one knows a little bit about biology and so on, one will say, oh, no, well, you know, this is, there's something that is not completely right here. And you can see here, what's interesting actually is that Darwin's original theory was actually rejected and disproven very soon after he published his book. And nobody, I mean, scientists or biologists today are actually not Darwinists. They don't believe in Darwin's theory. They have later on developed a later theory which is called Neo-Darwinism. And this is the theory of evolution they have today, but it's not Darwin's theory they have. The only comparison, similarity is that it's a natural process, but Darwin had a different theory. So if Darwin's theory was rejected, how can you say that he actually, he showed that you can have complex order and living organisms without a creator? He didn't. Darwin didn't show. He was proven wrong. Then they think they have another theory that proves it, but it's wrong to say that Darwin demonstrated that you can have complex life without a creator. It's interesting to actually, get a little idea about what was wrong with Darwin's theory. So because even there's still people who believe in it somewhat, or some of the rejected ideas of Darwin. So it's good to actually get an idea what was wrong with Darwin's ideas and theories. His first mistake was to claim or to assume that species are endless and immutable, and that through breeding, races or sorts may become new species. That was actually the most fundamental claim of Darwin, and in the first chapter in Origin of Species, he is looking at variety under domestication, it's called. It's how, what change can you cause in animals through breeding? And Darwin, he was a very expert, especially on breeding pigeons. He could create all kinds of varieties of pigeons. He was very expert in breeding. And it's also, I mean, you can't cause massive changes. Just think about dogs. You know, what kind of dog, you know, we have, you know, these tiny poodles are even smaller than that. And then you have these, you know, great Grand Danois, Great Danes, and actually they all seems like supposedly they actually come from the same one dog. It's one dog that, you know, bred in all these different varieties. So Darwin basically argues that if humans in such a short time, relatively short time, can create such massive changes in species, what cannot happen over millions and millions of years, and including new species arising through breeding. So that's actually his most fundamental claim of Darwin, and this is wrong. This is simply wrong. At least it has never been observed, and Darwin knew it. Here, there's a similar quote confirming this is what Darwin is saying. Nevertheless, according to my view, varieties are species in the process of formation, or are, as I have called them, incipient species. But sorry, Darwin, you're wrong here. And plant breeders know that, animal breeders know that.
Yeah, neo-Darwinists, they also have, substitute for that. I mean, they
also, they can also not. No, I'm getting to neo-Darwinists in a minute. Mm-hmm. Now I'm just looking at old Darwinists. But here, for example, there's a famous plant breeder. But in one situation, ask any farmer, any gardener, anyone working with trees like that. You know, there's limits to how much you can breed. But here, there's a, you know, just to have a famous plant breeder with the Burbanks. He writes here, I know from experience that I can develop a plum half an inch long, or 2.5 inches long, with every possible length in between. But I am willing to admit that it's hopeless to try to get a plum the size of a small pea or one as big as a grapefruit. I have roses that bloom pretty steadily for 6 months of the year, but I have none that will bloom 12, and I will not have. In short, there are limits to the development possible. And that's, it's not even, I could give many. There's no evidence up to this day that you get new species. You get, again, dogs of all kinds of sizes, shapes, colors, long fur, no fur, but you only get dogs. And there are limits, you know, you can breed a dog. Apparently, you can breed a dog to the size of a small mouse or to the size of a horse. You know, there are limits, it's, you know, it's within, but there's no evidence that it is otherwise, actually. So Darwin's second mistake, if you look at that, was that acquired traits are inherited. And by that, he has the idea. Anyway, here's a quote that will give you an idea of what is meant by that. Darwin writes, the great and inherited development of the udders in cows and goats in countries where they are habitually milked in comparison with the state of these organs in other countries is another instance of the effect of use that causes changes in the organisms. In other words, you milk cows and they get a bigger udder. As a result, their calves are born naturally with bigger udders. Is that sick? Yeah. He also writes, from the facts alluded to in the first chapter, I think there can be little doubt that using our domestic animals strengthens and enlarges certain parts and disuse diminishes them, and that such modifications are inherited, passed on. Again, Darwin is completely wrong here, but he's claiming that that, for example, you know, we might go to, you know, bodybuilding, and I might get some big muscles, you know, instead of being sort of tiny, skinny one, I might get some big muscles. Then as a result, I'll get children that have bigger muscles naturally. I might, you know, move to, you know, sunny country and get suntanned, and my children will have browner skin, and so on. But this is wrong. This does not happen. You know, it's for example, there are some countries in the world, women, they, you know, they enlarge their ears and their lips and so on by, you know, putting heavy weights in their ears and lips, because in this way to look more beautiful. But you know, girls in those cultures are not born with bigger ears or bigger lips. They're born like girls in, like anywhere else. It's not true that what we do to our body here in any way affects the, you know, the genes and the, what we are passing on to the to our children. It doesn't affect it at all. But that's Darwin's theory, and it's important. It's actually, you know, the mate is most important natural mechanism, because it's not that natural selection, meaning, you know, the survival of the fittest, that is the main mechanism of evolution. It's actually, where does new variety come from? That's you know, Darwin really needs that to explain how does characteristics which are not there, how do they arise in living organisms? And this is his proposed mechanism. Inherited traits are, no, acquired traits are inherited. And that's wrong. And that was shown by, at the same time, by Gregor Mendel. Someone knows him. He was in Austria. He was actually a monk, a Catholic monk living in the monastery. And he had experimented on, especially on peas, you know, plants. And he showed that actually, no, you don't, inheritance is not in a way affected by by the influence to the organism. You're actually passing on some very constant traits from generation to generation that are simply being mixed. This was mental. So here Darwin was proven wrong, and thus we had to talk about Darwinism and neo-Darwinism. Darwinism was again the idea that species are endlessly mutable, and external influences and use of organs create new genetic material. Acquired traits are inherited. And that was actually disproven around 1875 or something like that, which means that even though many people claim they believe in Darwin, they don't. They just don't know they don't believe in Darwin. That's a fact. And instead they're neo-Darwinists. And neo-Darwinism is the idea that genetic mutations create new genes which ultimately make a rise to new species in otherwise stable species. Because it was discovered that although generally inheritance means just constant characteristics are being passed on, sometimes there is a change. And these changes were first called freaks of nature. Later on, they become known as mutations. And in the 1950s, when the DNA was discovered, it was discovered it's actually chance changes when the DNA is being copied. This is actually what mutations are. So in the neo-Darwinism, that's the idea that mutations are giving rise to new variety, which is then being naturally selected to give rise to new species. Mutation is not Darwin. Sometimes people think Darwin mutation like this one. No, Darwin doesn't. He doesn't talk about mutation. It's a later idea. It's neo-Darwinism. Of course, then the question is you were asking. But what about neo-Darwinism? Can they explain life completely through natural processes? Well, there are reasons to think they cannot, and because well, it's not the question about mutation if they occur or not occur. The real question is, actually, mutations, are they beneficial to, or can they be beneficial? Because we know they cannot, I mean, they can be extremely harmful. Doctors, you'll see in medical doctors, they have books you know, thick books with all the diseases that are caused by mutation. There's that the Down syndrome is a quite known mutation disease, but there's so many diseases actually are genetic. They are caused by mutation, some kind of mutation. And many mutations also are neutral, have no effect. But beneficial mutations, good question. There are very few examples of them. And some examples are being given. I'm going to cite here with example about malaria and the malaria parasite. Malaria is a very terrible disease that is caused by a parasite that is transferred by mosquitoes. And what is interesting is there is a disease called sickle cell anemia. And it's people who have this disease, it's a mutation disease. Their blood cells are not round like normal blood cells, but they have a sickle form, like half moon. And it's a terrible condition because like 25% of those who have sickle cell anemia die. It's a deadly mutation disease. But what's interesting is that if you have sickle cell anemia, you become immune to malaria. So that means in countries where there is malaria, those who have sickle cell anemia, even though 25% die, but if 40% of all people die from malaria, that means those who have sickle cell anemia, they survive better in such an environment. So that's given as it's one example of a beneficial mutation. But again, you can see beneficial. It's a double-sided sword. It's not completely beneficial. But that's one. And there are a few examples also. Sometimes bacteria can develop resistance to antibiotics and like that. Mutations can, you know, do affect the organisms. But again, examples are very few. And one of my question, again, if we take a little more about malaria, here there's a map showing areas in the world affected by different strains of malaria. And as you see, it's all in the tropical countries. It's a tropical disease. One must say, why only in the tropical countries? And the answer is because malaria parasites cannot propagate, multiply, when the temperature drops below something like 16.7 degrees centigrade. As soon as the temperature drops below that, malaria parasites cannot multiply anymore. So that's why it's a tropical disease. Then one might answer, but why can they, just by mutation, develop tolerance to lower temperatures? One would say, must be possible because actually the number of malaria parasites that, you know, have been living for the last 10,000 years is greater than the number of mammals for the last 100 million years. I mean, the number of parasites is enormous. You have billions. If you have malaria, you have billions of parasites in your body, and then, you know, they multiply very fast. So there's been more malaria parasites living than mammals for 100 million years. And if mutations can, you know, create from a kind of a small rodent, a rat-like creature, create whales and bats and elephants and porcupines and human beings like us, why can mutation just create a tolerance to lower temperature in parasites? That would be a good question. But it turns out actually that if the parasites should tolerate lower temperatures, they would actually need many mutations simultaneously, more mutations that actually likely would ever happen, even with this staggering number of individuals or parasites that actually are generated all the time. Which puts a question mark also on, well, actually, what can it really be mutation that has caused, you know, the great diversity of mammals, for example, or living beings in general? I mean, there's no real evidence that mutation has that power. And actually, it's such a problem that there's here You can go on the internet and you can find this in a website called descendfromdarwin.org. Here you have over 800 professional scientists. These are natural scientists, scientists in their biologists, biochemists, physics, geologists, mathematicians, hard natural sciences, and a minimum PhD. You cannot put your list on this. Put your name on this list, on this, you know, minimum PhD. And they have signed this declaration that we are skeptical of claims for the ability of random mutation and natural selection to account for the complexity of life. Careful examination of the evidence for Darwinian theory should be encouraged. So there are many scientists who actually are very, very skeptical about this idea that mutations can cause, new variety, beneficial variety, to arise. Actually, it's such a problem in biology today that just a few years ago, in 2008, there was a big conference at a big institute, the Konrad Lorenz Institute in Vienna, in Austria, where 16 of the world's leading theoretical biologists were invited to come and present a paper. The conference was called Toward Extended Evolutionary Synthesis, and the organizer explained the purpose of the conference. They wrote that not only we have witnessed the molecular revolution from the discovery of the structure of DNA to the genomic era, but we are also grappling with the increasing feeling that we just don't have the theoretical analytical tools necessary to make sense of the bewildering diversity and complexity of living organisms. I mean, this is significant. I mean, if you take out this quote here, we just don't have the theoretical tools necessary to make sense of the complexity of living organisms. But we just thought that Professor Ayala said Darwin gave a theory that can explain the complexity of living organisms. Now say we don't have a theory. And that's actually a fact. It seems that they don't have a theory. So actually, one that you might say, has there been any improvement since the time of Darwin? Of course, we know more, and that's a problem. What is the cause of this feeling that the theory is not there? Is the astounding advancement of biochemistry and the understanding of what goes on in the cell. I'll just give you an idea. I'll show you a film clip here. Please follow carefully. It'll give you a glimpse about what is actually inside a cell. Darwin thought a cell was simple, but just look, it's anything but simple.
No matter how life began, on a vast crystal in the test tube of some intelligent designer, everyone...
Oh, I got him.
Spanish.
Yeah, but they speak English. Mm. It's just a Danish. You cannot hear this, can you?
No,
just let me see if we can get the sound back.
Species in 1859, published in 1859. He had an idea of the cell as being quite simple, correct?
Yeah, everybody did.
Yeah, okay. And if he thought of the cell as being a Buick, what is the cell now in terms of its complexity by comparison?
A galaxy.
If Darwin thought a cell was, say, a mud hut, what do we now know that a cell is?
More complicated than a Saturn V.
So what is in a cell as far as we know now?
A world that Darwin never could have imagined.
I needed someone who could give me a glimpse into this world. So we went to molecular biologist Doug Axe.
Think of a cell as being a nanofactory, a factory where, on a very small scale, digital instructions are being used to make the components of the factory. Here we have the famous DNA double helix. You can see the two helical strands that are intertwined and wind around each other on the outside of the molecule. This is the material that stores all of our genetic information. In higher life forms, this would be the equivalent of something like a gigabyte of information stored in the molecules that form the individual chromosomes, all packed within the nucleus, which is a tiny fraction of the entire cell size. So what does DNA do? Well, the information in DNA ends up providing the information for sequencing amino acids to make proteins. We have information in a one-dimensional form that provides the information for a three-dimensional form.
Scratching the surface of what's inside the cell.
When you pointed there, what did you say in the
video? I don't know if you caught, but there was a little man walking on two legs.
Oh, it was that, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. So actually, they're molecules, you know, robots, whatever they are. I don't know if they, it's a little bit. living people, but there's someone walking on two legs inside cells, carrying other molecules from one place to another, and stuff like that. So it's a, and anyway, it's amazing that in discovering that millions, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of scientists have spent millions of, you know, hours and days and years, you know, carefully, you know, trying to uncover what is inside the cell. So that is, you know, that's what they talk about, say, where did all this come from? And the actual fact is, there is no theory. We have no theory, meaning a theory of evolution or mechanical materialistic theory to explain this complexity of living organisms. It's and it's widely recognized. Here is a quote from one scientist. This was in 1998, it has not changed at all, but he wrote in 1998, "Today, as we leave the 20th century, we still face the biggest unsolved problem that we had when we entered the 20th century. How did life originate on Earth? This complexity in cells, where does it come from? No idea." There's no model of any chemical process that, you know, can even explain a fraction of what needs to be explained. That's the situation as it is now in terms of the theory of evolution. You know, Prabhupada, he challenged the scientists, must admit that they still do not know the origin of life. They claim that they will soon prove a chemical origin of life is something like paying someone with a post-dated check. Prabhupada said this in I think around 74. It's as true today as it was when Prabhupada said it. And it only becomes more and more true. So the thing is, actually, there is no theory of evolution, I think, as things stand today.
So all this, there's just speculation, or?
Yeah, it's belief. I can give you a little, but I say, we're not talking science. It's really not science. They still believe, and actually I just have a few more slides of this presentation, then I have two more presentations, and we cannot probably not, you know, don't have time to go through them, but one presentation is about why do evolutionists actually still believe in evolution when they have no theory, and then I'll try to give you some of the arguments for evolution and see if they, you know, if they're actually valid arguments for evolution. But it's not I mean, strictly speaking, it's not science. It's a belief that evolution happens. And then they just stop up this belief with, you know, some facts and like that. But no, there's no demonstration that evolution in principle can happen or has happened at all.
And common man is just becoming more and more convinced by
science. Yes, you know, that's the thing, it's just because you're just massively told, you know, the fact of evolution and like that. But that's why, you know, we have to know these facts so we can actually tell people when they are, you know, if we not also ourselves are misled by it, at least we have to explain to others you're completely misled. There is no theory, it's basically belief. And again, and let me just finish here with a couple of other quotes. This is from a book published by a cell biologist, published by Oxford. And he wrote here that we should reject as a matter of principle the substitution of intelligent design for the dialogue of chance and necessity. But we must concede that there are presently no detailed Darwinian accounts of the evolution of any biochemical system, only a variety of wistful speculations. So, of course, there's two interesting points here. One is the last point he admits. There actually is no real Darwinian account for evolution in any biochemical system. It's only speculation. And as a wishful speculation, it's just dreams, basically. And then, of course, also the other point is that we should, as a principle, reject intelligent design. It's just principle. We must reject the idea of intelligent design. That's interesting. I guess some of us will think, I mean, who has, you know, what's that principle? You know, who has who has made that principle. And actually, some scientists are actually questioning that. Here there's, this is one American, quite famous now, biochemist, professor of biochemistry, Michael Behe, who is one of the great critics on Darwinian theory, actually. And he particularly replies to this statement by this Professor Harold, the previous statement. He writes here that Harold's second point is that he apparently thinks there is some principle that forbids us from investigating intelligent design, even though design is an obvious idea that quickly pops into your mind when you see a drawing of the flagellum or other complex biochemical systems. He continues, I completely disagree with that view and I find it faint-hearted. I think science should follow the evidence wherever it seems to lead. So that's Behe. And there are many scientists now who are thinking like that. They are maybe a minority, they may be a majority, but of course their views have been quite suppressed actually. But there are scientists who think this is much more what science is leading us to.
Is it how the world of science works that, you know, it's very top, from top to down control, so to speak.
Yeah.
Is the old professors or those who have invested all their time and life in a certain...
Yeah, yeah. It's controlled by, you know, publication, by funding, and by, you know, tenure. Tenure means... Yeah. You have to have a job. If you don't have the right, you know, opinions, you may not get a job. You may not get published.
Yeah.
You may not get funding for your research. Mm. And this way, it's controlled.
Mm.
Theory might be true. So as scientists, we should just look at theory. There is a whole dark plot behind Darwin actually. But anyway, I don't think we should get in. I mean, it's good to know it, even in details, but we should not, in one sense, look at it. There's no point in criticizing the man. It's his idea. His ideas might still be true, even though the man is high Christian. Even though whatever Darwin else was. So we should look at his ideas. And this idea about intelligent design, actually, here's another scientist, you may know him. Saraputra. He actually, in a presentation in 1976 to Srila Prabhupada and other devotees, from the Bhaktivedanta Institute, said like this, we'd like to argue that the chance and molecular forces theory won't explain things like this, but to say that there is an intelligent designer would be a sensible explanation. That's also interesting. One point is that some have gotten the idea that when you speak intelligent design, it's Christians, it's, you know, Bible fundamentalists, it's Americans, and like that. But actually, that's not correct. Actually, Saraputra is speaking here in 1976, before anyone, even Christians, had any idea about intelligent design. He talks about intelligent design. So it actually has been amongst the audience before. We have been talking about intelligent design long before it became prominent in other circles. I don't think it means that we have, someone like Saraputra invented it. It's actually an old term. You can even find in writings from 1700s, 1800s, the term intelligent design. I think even someone found, somewhere Darwin talked about intelligent design in letters of someone. So it's an old term for the idea that there are traits in nature which cannot be caused naturally, but which are intelligently caused. I mean, design means pattern. And of course, all kinds of patterns in nature, but when you say intelligent design or intelligent pattern, it means a pattern created by intelligent being, by some deliberate action. But you see here, Saraputra is talking about that. So it's something, as far as I can see, we as devotees should be, you know, we should be on the cutting edge, we should be at the forefront of this and join forces with those who already are cultivating developing the arguments, these strong arguments. So I think that's yeah. This is this presentation. We have 25 minutes more, isn't it? We have to 5:30.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And what we can do, I can whatever questions you have, or I have two presentations more. One is about more detail what actually intelligent design is, and you know, and examples of intelligent design, how you can actually tell if something is actually intelligently designed or not. A little technical, but also very interesting. And then I have this other presentation about why do evolutionists believe in evolution when there's no science behind? And then we can look at some fossils. Does the fossil evidence prove evolution? Or does the embryos prove evolution? Or whatever.
How long time is each one?
I can do one, probably 20 minutes, I cannot do both.
You suggest that?
No,
The first one.
Yeah,
design.
Well, the design is actually, yeah. Yeah. So you can do that.
Miss, you mentioned before that Miss Stanley is species and yeah. Then other species, new species.
Yeah.
So how the natural species and then they do unnatural species, new species they create.
Yeah.
It means
No, they have never seen new species arise.
Yeah.
That has never, I mean, it's never been observed that new species have arisen in the in the time of human history. Neither naturally, neither on the breeding, neither in the laboratory. We've never seen species arise. Species vary, could become bigger, smaller, and so on, but they don't become new.
New species, they prove there's new species?
No, there's no proof. There's no proof that new species can arise. You can, but anyway, I mean, it's a technical discussion actually, and so you see evolutionists say, but there's this example, that example, and actually we have so many examples of it, they arise, but if you take a careful look at it, you'll find actually these are not correct, actually there was no new species, and I mean I'm discussing this in my book, there's a chapter on where the arguments forth and back, because that's it is a very technical discussion, it's difficult for lay people. Like, you will not be able to go after hearing this to a biologist, because he will need to give you, but what about this? What about what you heard is not true? I can give you this example, that example. Mm-hmm. So then you actually have to know, you know, actually many details
mm-hmm.
to, you know, evaluate the arguments really.
Because I think they say genetically, chimpanzee is 99%. Equal to human being.
That's one argument you might hear. First of all, this 99, 98, 95, 90, in different numbers.
Yeah.
Even that's doubtful.
Mm.
It's how they come to that. They're not really have any basis for it yet because they're not. Then they would have to compare the whole genome of the DNA. With this chimpanzee and all, and there's so many you cannot really compare. Like, I mean, they haven't made such a comparison yet. Anyway, I can get into it. They actually divide these numbers in a little different way. But you can say, so what? It's not surprising they're similar. We look similar. A chimpanzee looks similar to a human. So it's not surprising that also genetically we must look similar.
Mm-hmm.
But what does that mean, similar? Does that mean that so therefore it proves we must have evolved from a common ancestor or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Because like for example, you can also take like a, you know, Volvo and a Saab.
Yeah.
They look very similar. They have four wheels,
mm-hmm.
a steering wheel, they have windows,
mm-hmm.
But they were separate creators.
Mm-hmm.
They were not, didn't evolve by a Darwinian process to become two, you know, varieties of Swedish cars, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So the similarity is that they have a similar, they designed over the same, in this case, most economical way of designing a vehicle. So they designed called the design principles, mm-hmm. which also creates similarity in nature. This was Linné demonstrated similarity in nature.
Mm-hmm.
But he saw this was the unfolding of God's plan of design in nature.
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot say similarity in itself proves evolution. It might be evolution,
yeah.
It might be design. How can we tell?
Mm. Can I say, because many times it's said also that human being and the rat have so many similarities, that's why we caught diseases, you know, like from the rats. So is it on the basis of how the cell works, because it's cell in chimpanzee, cell in the rat, and
yes,
human being might be
it can be
similar.
Comparison of different sections of the DNA,
mm-hmm.
can be comparison of, we have similar proteins in our cells, and those proteins made of a long chain of a particular molecule called amino acid, and there are 10, you know, 20 different kinds of amino acids.
Mm-hmm.
So the one particular protein varies a little from species to species. So some of the, you know, particular protein might be similar. We might have our protein, one kind of protein might be more similar to the monkey protein, same similar in the monkeys and less to and so on. So you can make some comparison there. But my point is, what do these similarities prove or demonstrate?
Mm.
It might be a result of design, like the example of cars. They all look very similar,
mm.
but they're a result of design. How can we tell that life is not a result of design? We only look at similarity. And so that actually, but that's one of the arguments you actually will be confronted with. If you look at it, no, it's not. It doesn't prove evolution. It just proves similarity. You can observe similarity. What's the cause of the similarity? Might be design. Might be evolution. But for all that we know, we can't tell.
Mm.
And even it might be a guided evolution, but that's not Darwin. Might be like we talk, you know, we talk about Pragyabhiji's creating, that's actually also is a kind of evolution, but it's not a natural evolution we're talking about there.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else? No? Okay. So actually, what do we mean when we say intelligent design? I just gave you like a basic idea. Let's have a little more close look at what is actually meant by intelligent design, and also how we infer or assess intelligent design or not. How can we say for sure something is intelligent designed and not result of any physical natural process? That's a really good question. Prabhupada gave hints. Prabhupada was actually arguing for intelligent design or giving intelligent design arguments, and here. Have a problem then. Prabhupada here says, the intelligent man can see that neither the living entity nor the phenomenal world are creations of chance. The symmetry of creation and its regulated actions and reactions suggests the plan of intelligent brain behind them, and by genuine inquiry one may find out the ultimate cause. This is actually an argument for intelligent design. The symmetry of creation and its regulatory actions suggest there is a intelligent brain behind all this. Or Prabhupada, also this, you know, Prabhupada writes here, when we speak of law, we must understand there must be a lawmaker. That's in the intelligent design argument. And or science is discovering some subtle laws of the nature, but who made that law? As soon as you say that here is a law which is being carried very nicely, there must be a lawmaker. So probably it's arguing for intelligent design. It's like, for example, if you look at trains, and you might go down to the station, and you look at, and you find, actually find trains come very regularly, every hour, every very precise, a train is coming. So there's nothing about the mechanics of the trains and the mechanics of the rail tracks that causes trains to come on time. I mean, you just know that when it's so regulated, someone is there regulating it. And this is basically Popper's argument. And intelligent design is being defined by design theorists as it's a feature or something that happens, a feature that cannot be the result of any known physical process or of chance, and which is best explained as a result of an intelligent cause. And I'll give you some examples to get an idea what this precisely means. For example, archaeology. You know, you have archaeologists are studying implements and stones and like pebble, you know, flints they find, and then they are analyzing them. Can everything on these stones be explained purely by natural geological processes, or are there traits which can only be explained as, you know, deliberate work on these stones? So if they conclude, well, there's, you know, this stone here, this you know, cannot be arisen naturally, can only have arisen by deliberate work by someone, you assume it's humans, then they actually find intelligent design within ecology. Or that scientists, you know, who are trying to find evidence of intelligence in the universe, they are analyzing radio signals, and then they're trying to see if actually are they just natural radio signals, because many stars emit radio signals naturally, or are these intelligently caused radio signals? So far they haven't found anyone, but there was a movie came out some years ago where actually the scientists in that movie, they actually got a signal, and they concluded that signal is from some intelligent beings. And why did they conclude that? Because the signal was a signal of all the prime numbers from 1 to 101. Prime numbers are numbers which can only be divided by themselves and by 1. So it's 1, 2, 3, 5, and 7, and 11, and 13, and 17, 19, and 23, 29, isn't it? So they got a signal that first it was 1 beat, 2 beats, 3 beats, 5 beats, like all the way up to 101. So they conclude this can only be in some head. This is an intelligent signal. So they're finding like that. I mean, that's another example of concluding here's intelligent design. Here is a song. I'm a musician, and I'm playing the song because I like the song. That's one thing. But also, I don't know if someone were accusing Josh Harrison for having copied this song. The moment. Yeah, actually, Josh Harrison was pulled in court, and I think actually even lost the case. Another group claimed that you have stolen our song. And the court actually found the song so similar to each other that it concluded that you must have someone copied it. And he was actually had to pay a lot for it.
Really?
I don't think he did it deliberately. He might have it, you know, someone unconsciously like that. But actually the court ruled actually these songs are so similar, it cannot be chance. So that's actually one example also. This is assessing intelligent design, it's not chance. Still a nice song. But and probably, you know, probably gave him the idea for this song, for the text for the song. Here is another example. You might be a publisher who's publishing maps, isn't it? Or you might also, for example, before the electronic calculators, we had tables, logarithmic tables, and so on. So those who publish them, how do they protect their copyrights? Do you know that? Like, because how can you, you know, you make a map of an existing country, you cannot copyright, you know, the right shape of the country. Or if you calculate the right answers to a certain logarithm, You cannot make it have copyright on that. So, but then again, you have to protect the work because it's you know, to calculate these logarithms is a huge work, costing an awful lot. Do you know how they protect the copyrights? It's a actually what they do on maps. There are few false geographic, you know, towns that do not exist. Or in when it comes to tables, mathematical tables, there are out in the seventh and eighth digits there are some mistake deliberately put. Mm-hmm. So when someone copies it illegally, well, they cannot, okay, you cannot prove that you got the right numbers right, but to have the same wrong numbers wrong cannot happen by chance. Mm-hmm. So it must be cheating.
Mm-hmm.
So in this way, I mean, you can see actually this of assessing if something is by chance or by deliberate design. That's a discussion we find in many fields within science. So it's. But then one can ask actually, what is it exactly, precisely, that one finds when one finds design? And this was discussed by a mathematician called Dembski. William Dembski, and he has put up a what he calls an explanatory filter, where he I don't know if you can get it's difficult to say what this is, but I'll give you an idea. Suppose you have some you want to analyze it. You might have a monkey sitting on a keyboard, and just, you know, something is it's writing something. We want to know, is an intelligent monkey or not? So we have to look at what the monkey writes. So here it wrote these T-O. One can ask, of course, contingency, or the way you use this filter here is you go from the start, of course, and then you go and ask here first, is it contingent?
And what
does it mean? Yeah, I'll explain to you what the word is. But first you have to ask if it's contingent. And if it's no, then it's already, then it's not designed. But if it's yes, then it may be designed, but then you have to ask the next question, is it a complex? If it's no, then it's chance. And if it's yes, then he asks, is there a specification? And again, if there's no specification, it can be chance. And if there is a specification, it can be design. Okay, so now I'll try to explain what does he mean by these words by giving the example there. Of course, T-O doesn't mean, was it forced that it would be a T-O the monkey types? No, it could type any other letters. If it was a law, for example, contingence means it must happen. Every time you lift something, drop it, it must happen. That means it's a law. Then it's not contingent. Contingent means it does not have to happen. So that's so. So it doesn't have to happen that the monkey wrote T-O. So it's not a necessity. So we can go to the next and then ask, is it complex? And then it's, no, it's not complex. It's just two letters. It's not, I mean, so it can be chance. Mm-hmm. It needs to be chance. Next, we have here another sequence of letters.
Yeah.
So here, again, it's not contingent. So is it complex? Yes, actually it's quite complex, that string of letters. So that means you can go to the next. Is it specified? And here we say, no, it's not specified. And therefore it can be chance. And then we have a last string of letters that says to be or not to be, that is a question. Of course, it should have been a Bhagavad Gita quote, but it also uses for other presentations. And here is both contingent and complex. It's also specified. There is an independent existing pattern that corresponds to this pattern here. Do you understand? There's a language mean in this case. So if you go back, for example, to Josh Harrison's song. There was an independent existing song that existed independent of his song that matched it completely, it seems like. So it must be designed. There was a to the pattern of the scientists who found these radio signals from space. Well, the prime numbers exist independently of that pattern, therefore they conclude the sign. So Dembski concluded that whenever you find what he calls specified complexity, then you can be sure you have an intelligent designs pattern.
The first that I don't understand. Why if it's, you know, by law, if it's always happened,
yeah,
why can it not be designed?
We cannot say it cannot be designed,
no,
but it does not have to be.
It, okay.
Yeah. This filter does not exclude design, but it shows that it, I mean, it can only show that it does not have to be by design. Because the thing is, designers can also mimic natural processes.
Mm.
For example, criminals, they try to hide their tracks.
Mm.
So it looks like there wasn't another crime.
Mm.
So actually, so it looks naturally, but actually it's designed to look naturally. Okay. Mm. I mean, police, they have the task to show actually it's not natural.
Mm.
So that's the thing, you cannot conclude that it is not designed,
mm,
but you can exclude it's natural.
Mm.
That's how the argument goes.
Mm.
And so Dembski here writes, specified complexity is a sure marker of intelligent design. He likes the audience also, by the way. And so let's have a look at a couple of examples. There are many scientists now, cosmologists, who are arguing what they call the anthropological principle, which is the fact that the universe appears to be fine-tuned for life or for human life. And what they argue is that a number of physical constants have precise values that make life possible. If gravity, mass, density, strong and weak forces inside the atom, etc., were only slightly greater or smaller, life wouldn't be possible. Here, one English astronomer writes, Fred Hoyle, I do not believe that any scientist who examines the evidence would fail to draw the inference that the laws of physics have been deliberately designed with regard to the consequences they produce inside the stars. And of course, again, that's a long, could give a whole lecture on why things like that, but he thinks actually the process in the stars and the properties of the atoms and nucleus of the atoms are so specific that if they have been just slightly different, we couldn't have, for example, carbon or oxygen or iron or many of, and you show, you know, you just have the little adjustment and these elements would not have been there, which means there wouldn't have been life as we know it. Or here's another.
But they can, you can turn it the other way. I mean, if you're a Darwinist, I mean, for them it would not really mean anything, because the fact that there is life just shows that this exact, you know, how it is regulated, that made it possible for life to be, and therefore,
yeah,
we are here.
Here's something to hear that kind of argument, that didn't, but that's kind of more assuming it happens by evolution and by chance and like that. Yeah, they have assumed that it's true, and since we're here, therefore it must have happened by chance.
Mm-hmm.
This is circular reasoning,
yeah,
isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
They assume it, and then they conclude it must be true,
mm,
because we assumed it.
Yes.
So, no, that is, but that's very common, this is how they work, it's a fact. Here, Paul Davis, he writes, imagine playing God with the cosmos. Before you is a designer machine that lets you tinker with the basics of physics. Twiddle this knob and you make all electrons a bit lighter. Twiddle that one and you make gravity a bit stronger. You need to sit 30-something knobs to fully describe the world about us. The crucial point is that some of those metaphorical knobs must be tuned very precisely, or the universe would be sterile. He continues. Oh. Okay, one slide missing. But he continues giving the example of neutrons, inside the nucleus there are protons and then neutrons, and he gives example if as it is now, is it protons are just slightly heavier than neutrons, but if it had been the other way around, then the processes in the atom would not have been able to take place. No heavier elements would have been able to form. No heavy elements mean there would only be hydrogen from, you know, out through the whole universe existing. There would be no water, for example, no oxygen, no water, no life. And it says it's so precisely adjusted that it looks like the universe, someone had fixed the universe, just it's just right for life. I know I missed that. It's 5:30, and I think we should stop sharp.
Let's finish.
You can finish. I'm fine, I'm not in the rush, but I don't want to.
You're coming for me, you're coming
for me. Ah?
Because
there's
nothing else right now,
it's
a pause.
Yeah.
Those people
that
wanted
it
can even
reconsider.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
There is nothing till 6.
Yeah.
Okay, good, then we are relaxed. Because I wanted to get a little back to biology and give you an example of a DNA. That'll take 5 minutes. I want to again show you a video clip about DNA. What it is, and then talking about what implication this has for intelligent design. Here is a film clip about actually what the DNA is, what something about the things that it does.
Modern biochemistry has also revealed the unimaginably complex design of the DNA molecule. The structure of the DNA molecule was discovered by two scientists, James Watson and Francis Crick, in 1955. Their discovery demonstrated that life was much more complex than anyone had previously envisioned. Himself a confirmed evolutionist, Francis Crick, who received a Nobel Prize for this discovery, came to confess that a structure like DNA could never have emerged by chance. DNA is a giant molecule that exists in the nucleus of the cell. Every detail of a living being's physical and physiological makeup is coded in this double helix. All the information about our bodies, from the color of our eyes to the structure of our internal organs and the shape and function of our cells, are programmed in sections called genes in the DNA. The DNA code is made up of the sequence of four different bases. If we think of each one of these bases as a letter, DNA can be likened to a data bank made up of an alphabet of four letters. All the information about a living thing is stored in this data bank. If we attempt to write down the information in the DNA, this would take up approximately 1 million pages. This is equal to an encyclopedia 40 times bigger than the Encyclopedia Britannica, which is one of mankind's greatest single accumulations of information. But this incredible information is stored in the tiny nucleus of our cells, measuring about 1/1000 of a millimeter in size. It is calculated that a DNA chain small enough to fill a teaspoon has the capacity to store all the information contained in all the books ever written.
Wow.
I mean, it's mind-blowing. And DNA is very interesting because actually there are two features. It's very difficult to explain by any natural process. One is simply its complexity. Hypothesis is not complex, but it's just very big. DNA is a chain molecule, and the chain is actually just alternately a phosphate molecule and a sugar molecule. Phosphate, sugar, phosphate, sugar, phosphate, sugar. That's actually what it is, like that. And actually it's two strings. Phosphate, sugar, phosphate, sugar, and then they're interwoven around each other. But then on each sugar molecule, there is a one out of four possible molecules attached. And they, so these letters A, C, G, and T, they represent one of these four molecules. And so you have this chain which is millions of units long, and in each sugar molecule there is one of these four letters. So actually what is, of course that's complex, how the letter arise, but the thing that is the real significant thing is that this sequence of these four letters, they spell out a code. It's like, you know, you have like computer, you have ones and zeros, you have which are written on the hardware. But it's not the hardware that's significant, it's a particular sequence in which ones and zeros are ordered that contains information. So actually the information contained on the DNA is not the molecule itself, but it's a sequence of these particular molecules which are organized. So you have two things on the DNA. You have the complex hardware, the chemical structure, the molecule, but then you have the information written. So actually you have two things you have to explain, not just one. This makes it, you know, real difficult. Where does that text come from? It cannot have a chemical origin. It's here, if you're back again. Even Bill Gates, we have here, he admits that human DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software we've ever created. He would love to be able to create a software like that. He would become really rich if he could buy it. But it's the same principle. It's a written text.
One thing I was thinking of now when this was going on, that in crime now they investigate the DNA and can find a person. Then I was thinking, like in a public place, say door, you take yourself on a handle, there must be a lot of DNA. So you get it on your hand, but if you do something, how will your own DNA, I mean, if the person goes and do a crime, if that person has other people's DNA on their hand,
yeah.
How does that work?
I don't know. I've never been into, you know, I think it's called forensics. I mean, it's,
yeah.
You know, science of
mystery,
yeah. I'm sure they have ways of, you know, purifying. I don't know.
And it's
absolutely, you cannot really tell, they cannot really have been 100%
sure.
They can.
But if for example there's a crime and they find my, you know, there's some fingerprints or whatever, or the blood, and they find my DNA, I mean they take a sample from my blood and then also find the same DNA is found there, probably that they have a good case. So.
But they cannot really say if it is the same as yours. Because of this, that it's so complex probably.
Yeah.
But I just know that they cannot say. It's a likelihood.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
But now I was thinking further, then maybe what you get on the surface, it will easily go away, but what is from inside, it will continue to pour out.
Maybe.
This is interesting because it creates, you know, you. It's going on inside. It's interesting.
Yeah. You have to ask an expert from that field. I have no idea what they do when it comes to practical.
But a friend told, you know, because she's so clean, you know, no shoes inside the doormat and all that. And she told me once that if these bacteria you get from toilets, it will last for a certain time, and also other people's DNA will get off of you, and your own they will pour out it from inside.
Yeah.
That must be the answer.
It's a dirty world. So, then of course the question, especially we're talking about, where does this genetic text, this information, where does it come from? You know, what is the origin of it? We don't know any natural process. We know other kinds of information, for example, language, whether we speak it or write it, that's intelligent in cost. We know about software, that's intelligent in cost. Genetic code, which is the same thing. Well, we don't know where it comes from, but if we follow the principle, Newton, he gives in his Principia, where he writes, to the same natural effects, we must as far as possible describe the same causes. And he gives the example that if a stone or a rock falls to the ground in Europe and a rock falls to the ground in America, we must assume it's the same law of nature that is operating. It's not that one process causes rocks to fall to the ground in Europe and another process causes in America. The same effect, we must assume it's the same natural cause behind it. So if you apply this principle, we see in other cases where the cause of the information is known, is intelligently caused, then it's also reasonable to assume that the genetic code has an intelligent origin. Because it cannot be in physical origin. That's something. So that's an intelligent side argument also for the genetic, you know, for the genetic code. And
there's so many, so very convincing arguments.
The thing is, just get down into it, and the science has never been so strongly proving the existence of God as it does now. Mm. People are fooled into thinking that science is a problem for religion. The fact is the very opposite. Mm. And, there's some brilliant, also Christian scientists, even some scientists are arguing that Earth is not very old, but actually they're very brilliant. There's a website called Creation Evolution Headlines, where they are following from day to day all the latest science experiments, results, papers that have been published, and then they go and go through them and comment them and analyze them. And there was was it with fossils? Because I haven't even discussed fossils, but all kinds of fossils are completely against the idea of natural evolution. So there's some particular fossils where someone said this throws an atomic bomb into evolution. And they commented, yeah, it's like throwing an atomic bomb on a big piece of rubble. It's already a big piece of rubble, there's no theory. You throw a bomb, it doesn't change anything. The whole thing is rubble. But if you really get into it, you'll be amazed that anyone can believe in this theory. In next generation now, if you really think, how could they believe it? We're supposed to stop now. It's totally.
We like to continue a little bit. We will come before 6.
How to understand the Bhagavatam, the description of planet Earth or planets, they are not round, they are flat?
Oh, that's a complete different topic. I should not get into that topic now. But just briefly, Bhumandala is more than these planets. And it's actually seems like also it's a solar system. And Sataputta has written a lot about that. It's not so. It actually looks like it's true from a different perspective. It's a demigod's perspective and so on.
Because it's also the perspective that it's round. It's not only the flat.
Both things are described
simultaneously.
Yeah, but Prabhupada said that it's not round, it's flat.
No, it's both. You should be this book in perspective.
Yeah.
I just wanted to mention, because you said about the scientists who are trying to prove God, like anything. Oh, I know one who is called Greg Braden. I don't know if you heard about him.
Who?
Greg Braden. He has amazing things on the internet, many films about him. He has written many books. And one like Science of a Miracle. And when he speaks about DNA, it's interesting for devotees maybe also, because they have made some experiments. They took some saliva from one lady on a tissue, and they put it in another room. and she was in another room, and the DNA was behaving according to her feelings. How the DNA was behaving in her body was exactly so. DNA, it can expand or it can shrink, and if you are in a more spiritual or reckless, it expands. And he is proving that DNA can, by our DNA, we can change this this planet.
Yeah.
So if we are like good people, positive people, they have such an influence.
Mm.
And like the same with like mantras or chanting, or it's not only when we are chanting here, but it's influencing on us. It can influence the whole, like Yarna area. And they have made all kinds of experiments like this. But people, by meditating, they don't only influence like maybe peace here, but they can influence a huge area. And they were doing like experiments in different cities at the same time with their meditation and like praying for peace. And there were like, even aeroplanes were just going from USA and was supposed to throw some bombs somewhere, suddenly just turned back, and I didn't know why. No, nothing bad could happen when they were doing this in that area. No crimes have stopped. And
it's, all kinds of scientists are making these, so many interesting experiments, you know, going into what you can, it's called the paranormal, and it's a very, very big field. I have not, this Greg Braden, I've not come across him. I'll check into him. I've read some of, you probably know Rupert Sheldrake,
mm-hmm.
Someone knows,
he's
an English biologist who are, in my book actually, I'm writing about him. And he has one experiment where he, you probably heard about this, the dog and its owner. You heard about that?
Mm-hmm.
He made a very interesting experiment where he actually showed the dog was at home, and then there was a video camera filming the dog constantly just going and filming what happens at the door. And then the owner, she was out driving, and then she was riding the moment when she started deciding, no, I'm going home. And sometimes she would decide on her own, sometimes Rupert Sheldrake would send her a message, now you start going home. And it was sort of different times when she started going home. And then they could find actually, when she started going home, the dog would go to the door. and they made like 200 times they made the experiment. So there's no question about the dog can telepathically in contact with its owner,
mm-hmm.
and he's made all kinds of experiments like that. So it's
we've been talking about cells and molecules.
Yeah.
What's the smallest denomination from Vedic perspective? How do Vedas describe molecules? So
I don't know if they describe molecules, cells, or atoms as such. Of course, there's there are descriptions of Anu, very, you know, proper translated as atoms, if it's the same atom as the atom that we know, or what we call the atom, I think that we cannot tell. I never come across anything, or I heard anyone come across, you know, the cells, the DNA, all the biochemistry whatsoever.
What about Indra Gopa? What kind of creature is that?
Is it germ?
It's a germ.
But I don't know what, again, if it's a bug or it's a bacteria or whatever it is. I concluded that, I mean, it's not in the Vedas because we don't need to know it. Basically, I mean, one point, biochemistry discovery is fantastic and it's really amazing like that. On the other hand, it might be knowledge that is even dangerous for us to possess. They are, and what is happening is actually, you know, the genetic manipulation like that is the practical consequence of them actually entering into and being able to, you know, study the genes. And they are screwing up nature and causing harm by that. This is, you know, they know little, but they don't know everything. It's like when you, for example, sometimes in the computer you enter certain, files, or folders in the computer, and there's a warning, you know, if you start, you know, changing here, you're entering into the whole operational system. Don't change anything here. But that, the thing is, what they're doing is my feeling. They're going down, and they, you know, really start messing up things which they should not. Because then unless you're the expert programmer, you can go, then you can go down and work on the programs, but the rest of us with no idea, we would just ruin the computer. So I'd say ultimately it's not knowledge, you don't need that.
But the information like in the DNA could be, like Kafapita Vata, that's the constitutions.
That could be really,
information.
Yeah. But then like, what do you need from there's Kafapita Vata. You don't need more.
No,
it works well. And the thing is, we do not want to get into matter or the body, we want to be detached from it. So we should just have basic knowledge, just enough, so we can maintain our body and eat and not become sick and like that. We don't need more. But the result of this modern science is actually much more involved in matter and also much more attached to matter. So it's, I'd say, Vedas would say, why on earth should they have this kind of knowledge? Which just binds them more to matter, to repeated birth and death.
So like for instance, the Ramana actually got poisoned by his father, and some poisonous food. He offered it to Krishna, and it was not poisoned anymore. And now they also make these experiments where there is a very dirty water of, this from in Japan, from this, and they can pray. Water and the water is changing. All the bad things are going away. Or even blood, which is very cluttered, and if you pray, you have a good thoughts. It becomes like very beautiful.
Yeah.
Or like water can have beauty when they, when you even they do like they put on the water the love. They put a label on the water and it's written love, and on another they write hate, and then they freeze the water, and then later they see on the water which is written love. It has beautiful crystals like snowflakes, and another one is so ugly that like when I show it to my daughter, she couldn't sleep at night.
No.
So it's like things affect us.
If you talk about it in this context, actually for devotees should know this also. You talk about it. We should be, at least very familiar. I think you use a lot of this. Even our preaching, to some degree, when the what I'm writing is for the the very materialistic scientific community. So if I start getting too much into these things in my presentations, or if I write books about that, they would just write it off immediately.
Yeah.
It's I have in the end of the book, I do get into, of course, I have reincarnation studies, near-death experiences, and also, as I said, Sheldrake and also the other scientists who work with this. But it's in the end of the book, after they have gone through, just the biochemistry and the biology and the fossils and so on. It's I've tried, showing some paranormal in for example, in a university setting, and it's just, it's just completely, it's too much, it's too much for them in one sense. They in case they just switch off, even though I can, I have top Nobel laureates who work in the paranormal. I mean, there's, this French couple, Curie, discovered radioactive activity. They were also studying spiritism, and stuff like that. And they were really studying the paranormal. But even if a sort of scientific audience presents and the Curies are into it, it just they can think they cannot accept it. It's too much.
But NASA is doing this kind of
thing. Well, not for us. We of course we can, and it's good for it. It also confirms us that actually it's true. The Vedic description of reality is true.
Yes. I heard the scientists. They just to understand quantum physics, they think it takes like 10 years to just get into that different paradigm.
Yeah.
But I understand why into quantum. What to speak of
understand.
Yeah, and even, I mean, I don't know much about quantum physics. I was together with Rasarat, if you know him, from, he's an Indian, has a doctor in an institute in Mumbai. He's a quantum physicist. He was actually in Sweden last summer, around this time, at a physics conference in Växjö. There's a technical university there, and he stayed with us, actually in Copenhagen for a couple of weeks. So I discussed a lot of quantum physics with him, so I got a little idea. And when it comes down to it, even if you start quantum physics in 10 years, you probably just understand, nobody understands anything, and nothing on this makes any sense whatsoever. It does make sense, but it works. Quantum physics is something that works, but it doesn't make any sense.
But these nanostructures, does it make an upheaval of everything? Doesn't it?
Quantum.
Nano.
Nano is a much bigger level than the quantum.
Yeah, subtlety. I mean it makes the other thing, you know, turbulence in that. Nano is higher.
Yeah.
So that's everything. Higher and higher.
Yeah. Why did you
mention quantum physics in the beginning? I would feel that special before. You mentioned something about quantum physics in the beginning of this.
Oh, that was just a play on words. I said the Darwin changed the worldview. It was like a quantum leap in the change of worldview, going from a theistic to a completely atheistic worldview. That was just a poetic use of words.
What has been your profession?
I'm actually pretty much self-taught.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to study, I finished what is gymnasium, high school in mathematics, physics, science.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, I wanted to continue studying, but then I...
No use.
Yeah, and ended up, I was traveling, and then I concluded, no, why should I waste my time on this? Anyway, I'm just I wanted to become like an engineer. But then I started traveling, and I found out engineer means you just sit in an office the whole day. And I wanted to be out in nature, free, you know. So I thought, why should I become an engineer just to live a life which I don't like? And then I became a devotee, ultimately. And then, I've always been associated with the Bhakti Institute and whatever comes out from there. And, the basic self-taught. Like Darwin. He's not trained biologist, he does. Did it.
So when we read biology at the gymnasium, then they only knew that the DNA decided what kind of proteins would be produced.
Yeah.
Then they didn't know, they couldn't say that in what sequence or what exactly.
No.
How.
When you went, that was in the 70s?
Yeah, when was it? Late 70s.
Yeah. I mean, they knew the genetic code at that time. And which means that they knew this system of the nucleotides, A, C, Gs, Ts, in sequence and like that. They didn't have any techniques to really sequence or find a sequence, long sequences and like that. It was very slow processes.
Mm.
One thing is also, at that time, the scientists probably knew more. Your teachers were like probably 20 years behind, and the books were probably 20 years behind.
I just remember I felt completely cheated. Because I thought, now I read, but now I will figure out how, Darwin is right. And then I just saw that they had no idea.
No, they had no idea. And that's, I know Sariputta, he describes it in his experience in one place. He said he was always interested in really getting some good answers about life and origin of life. So then he thought, when I get to he was in high school, But he was not satisfied with the answers, and he thought, okay, when I go to college, then they found actually it just became more confusion. Then they, at the university, they must have some new. And then he went to the university, and then he got even worse than that. and then he just gave up.
Okay.
I think
yes,
we must stop now, isn't it?
Yes, 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Hi, Christian. Thank you for your attention.
Some pressure is supreme.